Over the last decade, the United States Supreme Court has ruled that juvenile capital punishment and mandatory life without parole sentences are unconstitutional. The judges cited neuropsychological research about the limitations of adolescent brain development and determined that the unique traits of adolescents' cognitive and emotional development are significant mitigating circumstances when considering the punishment of minors. In the 2016 case, Montgomery versus Louisiana, the Supreme Court ruled that the decision applies retroactively, but left no guidelines for how judges should resentence more than 2,100 people who fall into this category nationally, many of whom have been in prison for decades. Keith Hicks was one of those young people sentenced as an adolescent to life without parole. In 1994, when he was 16 years old, he participated in a gang-related homicide in retaliation for the murder of one of his friends. Now, at 41 years old, he has spent the last 25 years of his life in prison. During his sentencing, the mitigating circumstances of his life as a youth growing up in Beltzhoover, as well as the particular limitations of adolescent developmental neuropsychology, were not considered. This is his story.
I think it is important to get a picture of what the context of adolescents, of children and adolescents growing up in neighborhoods like Beltzhoover was like.
My mom's was a super hard worker as a nurse's aide, and my pops was into construction. My dad could fix, build basically anything, but he was temperamental. And when he gave us beatings sometimes, it was borderline child abuse. Some of it was. But that is how he was raised.
See, Beltzhoover has gone amongst many changes. The Beltzhoover I grew up in my early years is completely different than what you see on the news and society will tell you. Completely different. This was a neighborhood of manicured lawns. You had, there were homeowners association. Like, you would get a fan if your lawn wasn't manicured when I was little. There were multiple businesses. It was a great place to be. None of my other friends in other neighborhoods, they even knew where it was. Like, everyone was like, Beltzhoover, what is that? Where's that? So this was a neighborhood that had privilege. It was working families. Jamil and I and Jamar, our father, we're a part of the last generation in Beltzhoover where we all had dads at home. Like, what do you mean you don't have a dad? Like, my mom and dad, even though they're still together now, like, as though their parents are still together. All my friends, we had our moms and dads.
I was 7 years old when I moved to Beltzhoover. The neighborhood was a beautiful neighborhood. 80% of the households were two-parent homes. The graduation rate was probably in the upper 80s for high school. Up until the time I was, I think, 18, I didn't know of anyone ever being shot or killed. Maybe someone did get shot, but he didn't die.
When the steel mills closed, African Americans were disproportionately hardly hit by losing jobs, either becoming unemployed or getting jobs that did not pay the bills. So you had an increase in poverty rate in general in Pittsburgh, but even more so in African American neighborhoods like Beltzhoover.
It was coincidental that when that mills, the crack, all that seemed to happen, it was a confluence, all of it at one time. The closing of the mills, the introduction of the crack cocaine, and the introduction of the gangs. All seemed to coincide between 88 and 93, which is when most of the violence occurred.
We lived in a really nice house, dogs, fence, all that. But my pops became an alcoholic, then a crackhead. My mom ain't know he was smoking crack for a while, and he would steal money from her and blame us and punish us for it on top of it. But me and my brother knew he was on drugs, because by then Beltzhoover became one of the city's biggest open drug markets. And he would buy crack off of our friends, 12, 13, 14 years old. and we would get made fun of for it. But the crazy part is, all my friends had one or both parents on crack, with the exception of a few. So we all felt each other's pain, even though sometimes we contributed to it.
But at that point in time, I mean, I didn't want anybody to know my dad was on drugs, specifically crack, because that's, you know, kids rip and everything else, but that was going to be something that I don't know how I was going to respond, because it was the truth. I was living it. It was a nightmare.
So this upwardly mobile neighborhood that used to have predominantly two-parent households experienced the influx of the crack epidemic to a very powerful degree.
All that hit at the same time, and Keith walked right into it.
Mm-hmm.
And his lifestyle, his home style, made him a perfect candidate. Because he, you know, it was crazy. If his dad would have stayed the way he was, as intelligent as Keith is, there's no telling what he could have been.
I started looking up to the dudes on the corner. Although the guys I hung with all were not drug dealers, we kind of formed a bond out of pain. And that was the beginning of a gang. But at the time, we ain't call ourselves a gang. We just had each other's back. If you were hungry, we fed each other. Those of us who did sell drugs provided.
This is a period of heightened sensation seeking that not always, but can lead to risk-taking behavior. The adolescent brain has to be more reactive that might be informing culpability during a crime that is done during the adolescent period. So they were on adolescence. Adolescence is fleeting. We don't know who that individual is going to be once they become an adult. And they are more prone to their environmental circumstances, but also may be more amenable to rehabilitation.
So we do have a lot of data that shows that over time, young people do change, that what they do, what marks them as an adolescent, isn't necessarily who they're going to become when they're older. And there are many, many examples, and again, a lot of evidence that points to this capacity of young people to change.
Can I look at a brain and see this brain is a criminal brain?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely not. The adolescent brain may be more amenable to rehabilitation mm-hmm. than that of an adult.
Child and adolescent development always happens within a context. And the context of children like Keith, who grew up in African-American neighborhoods in the 1980s and the 1990s, gives us a picture of how difficult it was for children to navigate their way into growing up into adulthood.
In thinking about the community context is exposure to violence. So there's an increasing amount of evidence that indicates that just being exposed to violence can have negative effects on young people and young people's behavior. So when we see, particularly in situations where you have communities with very high rates of violence in that community, we're learning now that that can really affect and shape a young person's outcomes and a young person's actions, right? How do they respond in that context?
I had no peace at school, always getting jumped. I hardly ever stayed at home anymore because there were bloods that wanted to kill me. So I stayed over friends' houses in Beltzhoover, so it reinforced this extended family thing. I'm not alone. All of us had hard, crazy lives, so we related to each other. Even when we couldn't tell our parents what was wrong or a school counselor, we could feel each other's pain without all the words. Feel me?
When I wasn't in the gang, I still had to fight the gang fights. So by the time I got to Carrick High School, which people from St. Clair, Beltzhoover, you know, rivals were in there, I didn't have trouble in the high school as much as I did getting off the bus in the afternoon. I would get off the bus and our bus stop was in Mount Oliver, which is here. And that puts Carrick up here. So, you know, you still had to catch the bus to Beltzhoover. And when I tell you the stores would empty out with guys from St. Clair, 4, 5, 6 years older than me. And you had to fight almost every day. So it was almost like I either roll with my cousins and the crew because I'm fighting those battles anyway, or, you know, continue to fight standing on my own.
You couldn't go to school with just your books. Like, you had to have your books, your book bag, and a gun.
Many of the young men, particularly if they came from homes that did not function very well anymore, came together and found friendship and a sense of belonging, a sense of identity among the other young men. Because the older generation, the older men who used to be the mentors, were either now drug dealers or there were parents, fathers, older men who had become addicted to drugs and then had become incarcerated.
I've done some research and, you know, age is related to misconducts. So juveniles don't do time well. And it relates to a lot of those issues that we talk about in terms of development, in terms of the institutional structure, but they don't do time well. So the question, you know, it's very clear that a lot of them are going to get misconducts. But then what's the pattern of behavior as they're maturing? Do we see the misconduct, the behavior that got them misconducts or prison infractions? Do we see that decline? Do we see that decrease?
I wrote an apology letter and sent it to Harrisburg. I don't know if his family requested it. Part of me wants to beg them for forgiveness so bad. I would want them to know that I know I had no right to take their son's life. He could have been anything, and I took that away. I would want them to know that I am no longer the same dude I was when I came to jail.
If somebody has a long period, 15 years, 10 years, you know, 20 years of no prison misconducts, no infractions, that's a very positive sign. It's a sign that, you know, that one, I do think that maturity is taking hold, but it's also, when you look at the literature and when you look at criminal offending, a lot of times it's not, you know, the offense that somebody commits isn't predictive necessarily of whether they're going to keep. It's the pattern of behavior, right? So are they what we refer to the criminal or the career criminal, as opposed to just, you know, an adolescent limited? So when we're looking at young people, we're looking at those patterns. And I think, you know, prison behavior, we can look at it in the same way, in that, you know, if they, as they're adapting to the institution, commit some infractions or behave in certain ways, and then that stops and it goes in a different direction. Again, to me, in my take on the literature and my take on my own work, this is a positive sign in terms of their ability to adapt to the outside world.
I have a very strong support system. My big brother made it. He went to junior ROTC, made it to college, and became a teacher. Takes care of his family like a real man. His wife, 2 kids, and my mom live with him.
So how has Keith changed over the past 24 years? Number one, he's grown. But when I say he's grown, it's just that he's grown. As I've grown, as you watching this, we're growing now. Time has changed. He's matured. He set goals for himself. You know, ultimately, one of them would be to be free. That's out of his hands. But he's preparing himself that if that ever does come about, he will be ready.
Another thing that I think we can point to with regard of to thinking about whether somebody's going to be successful is, what did they do while they're in prison? What did they do for themselves in terms of bettering themselves, gaining skills, developing, and what are they doing for others as well? So I've talked to a lot of prison officials who've talked about how juvenile lifers can be a stabilizing influence in their institutions, in their settings, that they can play a positive role for younger inmates in particular in the prison setting. So looking at how they've spent their time, how did they do their time?
I do know one thing for sure. I will never pick up a gun again. I feel like I have a gift for reaching younger dudes. And when I feel the opportunity presents itself, I try to save lives. I try to plant those seeds of life.
Adolescence is temporary. Mm-hmm. And I often will look around and go, we were all adolescents. Mm-hmm. It's actually very brief.
Yeah.
And we don't know who that person's going to be yet.
Over the last two decades, Keith has gone from being an incarcerated, misguided teenager to a thriving, mature adult whom many others look up to and respect. He has completed a wide range of trainings, certificates, and programs, many of which are only available to inmates with good standing, and others require recommendations from prison authorities. He has completed his HVAC and carpentry certifications, completed a peer counseling certification, and participated in the therapy dog training program. Recently, he has taken Spanish and business classes. As a peer counselor, Keith is often approached on the block or in the yard by inmates who struggle emotionally or face dilemmas such as whether to avenge violence done to them. Two late evenings every week, Keith is asked to do a suicide watch. He walks the hallways of the solitary housing unit, as well as death row and the gang unit, to offer support and counsel to inmates who have no one else to talk to. Keith also runs a group called Double Trouble, which is part of a dual diagnosis program for men who struggle with both substance abuse and mental illness. Keith is engaged nearly all day every day in making a difference for himself and in the lives of others. Freedom. Willing to die for my freedom. Can I retire for my freedom? We'll be all right when we come. Cause that's when I'll get my freedom. Willing to die for my freedom. Can I retire for my freedom? We'll be all right when we come. Cause that's when I'll get my freedom. Willing to die for my freedom. Can I retire for my freedom? We'll be all right when we come. Cause that's when I'll get my freedom. Willing to die for my freedom. Can I retire from freedom? We'll be all right when we come. Cause that's when I'll get my freedom. Willing to die for my freedom. Can I retire from freedom? We'll be all right when we come. Cause that's when I'll get my freedom.